Hi friends, how are you? Welcome today to our program. The program is the 40-day new life journey, and the book we are using for that is called The Purpose Driven Life. Again, if you want this book, it's on Amazon, I'm sure. Just type in Purpose Driven Life and you'll get it. We're on chapter 16, which is day 16, and we're gonna try and go as quickly as possible so we're not holding anyone back from their regular chores. So welcome on board. Today is day 16 of our plan, 40-day plan. And like I always say, this is quite exciting to me because every day I read a new chapter, I learn something new. And what we normally ask is if anything has changed in your life since you've been watching this program, feel free to chat with us. We are more than happy to respond back to you. We're trying to, as usual, go live on Facebook and live on Instagram, but technology, we've been having these issues, we're still struggling with it. So if it goes off at any stage, just go on YouTube. We're recording it for YouTube. Go on YouTube. We have it daily. Every day that we've done it is on YouTube, so then you can take your time and watch it properly, and of course email us or send us messages from YouTube. So day 16, and the question was, what matters most to us in life? Remember, we've got lots of lessons so far, which I talk about from time to time, but because we reviewed quite a lot of lessons yesterday, we're going to just concentrate on what today brings. He said, no matter what I say, what I believe, and what I do, I'm bankrupt without love. And this is 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 3. Love means living the way God commands us to live. As you have heard from the beginning, His command is this: live a life of love. Oh, thank you so much. Someone just said they love my hair. You remember we have this hair in stock, so feel free to go on our website and order it. It's hairextensionsandbeauty.com. We call them the million braids, million twists. This particular unit is called the messy hair. Okay, so love means living the way God commands us to live. As you have heard from the beginning, His command is this: live a life of love. And this is 2 John chapter 1, verse 16. Today's program is so exciting because it's such a major part of our life, and it's something that we all need to know about. So when I read these things and I get so super hyped up, and I feel so happy that I'm sharing this with you. I really, really am happy. So life is all about love. That's the most important thing we all have to take on board, because God is love. The most important lesson He wants you to learn on earth is how to love. God wants us to love. It is in loving that we are most like Him. So love is the foundation of every command He has given us. The whole law can be summed up in this one command: love others as you love yourself. Now, when I read this part, it was quite interesting, because I know there are lots of people who struggle with even loving themselves. And you hear them say, but I really don't love myself. It really makes you wonder, why would anyone not love themselves? But anyway, so if you're not one of those people who struggle with that problem and you really do love yourself, what God is saying to us is we must learn to love others as we love ourselves. But I personally call it something different. I call it treat others as you would want to be treated. Now, love and treatment is saying the same thing. So when you love yourself, or when you love anyone, what do? You care for that person. You're there for that person. You don't want anything to hurt that person. So this is the same thing we're talking about treatment. You will not treat other people badly if you would not want them to treat you badly. So the way you want to be treated is how God is expecting you to treat other people. And you hear people say all kinds of things: they were rude to me. So if you're not rude to people, then people will not be rude to you. They were looking at me funny. How did you see them? They were not nice to me. How did you behave in a way that they were not nice to you? So these are the, it is reciprocal. So whatever you give out is what you're getting now, getting back. So when you're not nice to people, naturally people reflect back what you've given them. So what we've been told here is we should learn to love other people the way we love ourselves. And I'm saying treat other people the way you want to be treated. So lots of us want love, but we don't give love. We want to reap where we did not sow. We generally expect from other people, but we are not willing to put anything in. And this also goes even in business. You hear people will come to you, they want to get free service from you, but they will not offer their service free. I had an instance where, this was on Facebook a long time ago, and this young lady was asking me to sit with her and give her some information. She wanted to consult with me on how to work with her. And I did say to her, okay, for the kind of information you want, come on to Skype, we're gonna have a chat, and that will be just £20 an hour. And she freaked out. But I was seeing this lady's Facebook feed, and she's charging people $150 for her hair service, and she wanted to perfect it. So she's come to me to give her advice on what to do, but £20 was too much to put down. But she's happily collecting $150 from other people without giving them the right service. So when you want people to treat you well, you have to learn to treat people well. So if you want people to give you, learn to give as well. And this goes across everything we do. Give and you receive. Sow and you will reap. So here we're being taught about love. So learning to love unselfishly is not an easy task. This chapter is telling us. We are generally self-centered by nature. That's us human beings. We're just so self-centered. It's mostly about us. It's mostly about what about me all the time. And so this is why we are given a lifetime to learn to love. So being on this earth is one of our biggest lessons, to learn to love. This is one of the things God wants us to learn to love people. Jesus said, our love for each other, not our doctrinal belief, is our greatest witness to the world. So, you know, as Christians, most times we just talk, and it's all about passages. We quote them and quote them and quote them. And the biggest task that God has given us is love. But we still don't love each other. I mean, there was a weird story. Somebody told me that they went to church, and after the service, some person was having a party or something in church, and the person had announced that they were going to have a party after church. And so they were going to the house. This person invited them to the house to come and celebrate with her. And as they were leaving the service, so she was saying to the grandma, okay, let's go and join them at this party. And the grandma said, we don't go to those people's house. But they were in church. And they were just having this amazing service where everybody in church was pretending to be friends and loving each other. And suddenly this was a test. Let's go to their place to have this party. We don't go to their house. But you're in the same church, loving each other supposedly. So as Christians, we just talk with our mouth and pretend that we love. When we are actually tested to show love, we don't prove it. And that's what this chapter is telling us. Jesus said our love for each other is not our doctrinal beliefs, is our greatest witness to the world. So this love is what we then prove who we really are. He said, your strong love for each other will prove to the world that you are my disciples. So most times, I say to us when we all say we're Christians, do we behave Christ-like? That's what it is. Christians are supposed to be following Jesus Christ's way of life. And if we can't love each other, where is the Christ in us? So in heaven, we will enjoy God's family forever. But first, we have tough work to do here on earth to prepare ourselves for an eternity of loving. Loving is the big thing here. God trains us by giving us family responsibilities. And the foremost of this is to practice loving each other. So it starts from the family. How much of each other do you love truly in your family? You know, like cousins and further cousins and nephews and nieces. How many of these people do you really love? Even direct sisters. How much of that love do you really share? Mother and father. sister and brother. Is it one of those instances where distance just shuts everything out? We are being tested by God to show love. God wants us to be in regular close fellowship with other believers so we can develop the skill of loving. Love cannot be learned in isolation. So loving itself cannot be learned. You cannot just love for the sake. You cannot just say, I love, and is in isolation. He says, we have to be around people. Now, for you to love, you have to love a human being. So you have to be around somebody to say you love that person. And this is where the test comes in. These people may be irritated. These people may be imperfect. These people may be frustrating. But through fellowship, we learn three important truths. So when we are living with people that we find irritating, imperfect, frustrating, God is testing us to learn to love these people. The basis of life is love. And he's given us, he says there are three major things we must learn about love. And number one is the best use of life is love. Love should be our top priority, our primary objective, and greatest ambition in life. Love is not a good part of our life. It is the most important part of our life. So love is not a good part of our life. So you're thinking, oh yeah, it's just a good part of our life. No, it is the most important part of our life, love. The Bible says, let love be your greatest aim. That's what the Bible said. Let love be your greatest aim. It is not enough to say one of the things I want in life is to be loving. Because there are people who say that. Oh, I want to be really loving. Relationships must have priority in our life above everything else. And it says why. Life without love is really worthless. If you have a life and you don't have love in it, it's completely worthless. And Paul made this point. No matter what I say, what I believe, and what I do, I'm bankrupt without love. So if there's any questions, please feel free to ask. And we're quite excited that you're tuned in and chatting with us here. Like we say, by the end of these 40 days, we really, really hope to see changes in our life. And that's what we call it, a new life. Often we act as if relationships are something to be squeezed into our schedule. So now he's beginning to break it down, what it means about how love is so important in our life. He said, life without love is really worthless. And he's trying to break it down to say that no matter what happens, we need relationships, and relationships must be the priority of our life above everything else. And he's starting to explain it. He said, often we act as if relationships are something to be squeezed into our schedule. So in a day you're thinking, oh my goodness, this is my sister, this is my brother, this is my daughter, this is my husband, this is my wife. Let me just squeeze them into my daily life because I've got a lot I'm doing. He said, we talk about finding time for our children. So you have to, because you're so busy, you have so much you're doing. Oh, let me squeeze a little time to be around my children. This gives the impression that relationships are just a part of our lives, along with many other tasks. So the relationships that you have, you think is a tiny little part of your life. It's not an important part of your life. But God says relationships are what life is about. Whatever relationship you have in your life, that's what life is all about. So 4 of the 10 commandments deal with our relationships to God. So he's explaining it now. Remember the 10 commandments. He says 4 of them deals with our relationships to God. 4. The other 6, the remaining 6, deal with our relationships with people. We're looking at relationships now. But all 10 commandments are about relationships. So what he's trying to explain here is life is about relationships. That's the big thing about life. He said Jesus summarized what matters most to God in 2 statements. Love God. Love people. That's what Jesus said. We must love God and we must love people. That's the 2 biggest things that makes up what our life is. He said, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart. Jesus said that to us. And this is the greatest of all the commandments. You must love the Lord your God with all your heart. A little bit of hair came to my mouth. Love your neighbor as yourself. Remember, we just mentioned earlier how love is not... Well, there was something we just said about loving. Love others as you love yourself. So now he's telling us, love your neighbor as yourself. So the first one was, love God with all your heart. And the second one is, love your neighbor as yourself. All the other commandments and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. So everything else that the prophets have told us are generally based on these two commandments. Love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. After learning to love God, learning to love others is the purpose of your life. Remember, this whole book is about purpose driven. What is the purpose of our life? And he's trying to explain to us that the first thing is that we must learn to love God. And you remember in all the chapters we read is our life is for the pleasure of God. But after the first commandment, which is loving God, the next one is love people. Love your neighbors as you love yourself. Relationships, not achievements or acquisitions of things, are what matters most to life. The relationships you share with people, not the amount of things you own and the targets you met and all the amazing things you achieved in this world. That's not what matters most. So why do we allow our relationships to get the short end of the stick? That's the question he's asking us. When our schedules become overloaded, we start skimming relationships. We cut back on giving the time. We cut back on giving the energy and attention that loving relationships require. What's most important to God is displayed by what's urgent. So what's urgent is what matters most. You see, busyness is a great enemy of relationship. So what happens is most times when we get so busy, we get so engaged with ourselves, we cut our people in from our lives. We become preoccupied with making a living, doing our work, paying our bills, accomplishing goals as if these tasks are the point of life. That's what we think. We think all these things are the point of life. Someone just said, I love my job. Thank you so much. I love you for being here with me. Thank you. He says, paying bills, accomplishing goals as if these tasks are the most important thing. That's what we just generally think. We think being preoccupied with making a living, that's what life is all about. That's not it. They are not. The point of life is learning to love. That's the point of life. We have to love God and we have to love people. Life minus love equals zero. That's what he's telling us. He says, love will always last forever. I remember he was giving us three things we must know about love. The first one was the best use of life is love. So this is the second one. Love will always last forever. So another reason God tells us to value love is because it lasts forever. These three things continue forever. And he gives them faith, hope, and love. These are the three things that last forever no matter what you do. He says, the greatest of them all is love. Love leaves a legacy. How you treat other people, not your wealth or accomplishment, is the most enduring impact you can leave on earth. So the way you treat people is what people remember. They're not remembering you because you were this extremely rich person. They're not remembering you because you achieved such a great thing. They're remembering you the way you touched lives, the way you were with other people. You see, Mother Teresa said, it's not what you do, but how much love you put into it that matters. So whatever you're doing and you put a lot of love in it, that's what matters. And what I'm doing right now is a good example, because I've created time, these 40 days that I've decided to be with you with this book. I've put aside everything else that I was doing. Now to me, it's a huge thing I'm doing. Because this will live long after I've gone. People will remember that there was a time I sat down to read a book with the world. Now that's a legacy, and that's how you touch lives. So Mother Teresa is saying, anything you do and you put love in it, that's what matters. Love is the secret of a lasting heritage. And he's given you a, this example was so amazing. This example I'm going to read now. He said, at the bedside of people in their final hours. This is him. He's given an example of, he's been around people who are dying. And he sees by their bedside, like their last final hours, what's happening before they finally go, give up the ghost. And he says, they don't say, bring me my diplomas. They don't say, bring me my degree certificates. They don't say, bring me my qualifications. They don't say to you, show me my awards. I want to see them one more time. They don't say, where are my medals? I want to see them. Where's my gold wristwatch? Where's my designer clothes? Bring me all those fancy houses that I bought all over the world. And where are those my amazing cars, the prestigious ones, Bugattis and you name them, Ferrari, where are they? No one remembers these things when they are dying. No one says, can you send me my political position? So you see these people who go crazy with politics. When is that time, that final hour, they don't remember. I thought I was the minister of whatever. At this moment, when is the last minute, when life on earth is ending, people don't surround themselves with objects. So they don't remember any of these physical things that we attach so much importance to. All those things don't matter anymore at that last minute. And a dying bed, a few minutes to go, all they say to you is, I want to surround myself with my loved ones. What we want around us at that time is people we love and people we have relationships with. And you find most times, if a daughter wasn't there when the dad died, all the daughter is crying about is, I didn't hear him say, tell me the last words. I didn't see my dad, his last words. And I felt so empty without it. So this is what life is all about. It's those loving relationships that count so much. It's those loving relationships that matter so much. So in our final moments, we all realize that relationships are what life is all about. Wisdom is learning that truth sooner. Wisdom is learning that truth sooner rather than later. That's what wisdom is. Knowing that life is not about physical objects. Life is more about these enduring relationships called love. He says, don't wait until you are on your deathbed to figure out that nothing else matters in life. And so now he's going to number three. Remember, he was giving us three important things about love. He said, we will be evaluated on our love. And the third reason to make learning to love the goal of your life is that it is what we will be evaluated on in eternity. So one of the ways God measures spiritual maturity is by the quality of your relationships. So whatever relationships you are having here on this earth, which is a learning process for us, remember? Because we may meet people that are really irritating. We may meet people that are really imperfect and are frustrating. But it's a learning process. Remember what God said to us, that it is a test. Life is a test. So whatever we're experiencing here, there are things that we're meant to overcome. And so he's trying to explain to us now that one of the ways God measures spiritual maturity is by the quality of our relationships with these people that may be irritating or imperfect. He said, in heaven, God won't say, tell me about your career. So when our life is over and our spirit is gone and we get into our creator, he's not going to ask you, okay, now tell me about your career. How did it go? He's not going to say to you, and what about your bank account? How much did you leave in it? He's not going to ask you, and those hobbies of yours, how amazing were they? But he will review how you treated other people, particularly those who needed you. So relationships is a big message from this chapter. Jesus said the way to love him is to love his family and care for their practical needs. So truly, this is Jesus talking to us now. Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, who are members of my family, you did it to me. So when people are in need and you're there helping them out, you're actually helping God. So when you see people in need and you just walk away, you're actually walking away from that opportunity to do something for God. So when you transfer into eternity, you will leave everything else behind. And we made that very clear in this discussion, in this book. Everything we chase and stress ourselves over, because I remember the day we had someone asking us, but how do I cope with stress? All the things we are doing with stress on this earth is not going to go with us. None of it will go with us. All that jewelry, all that cars, all that careers, all that qualification, and you just name it. None of it will go with us. It's those relationships we have with people that will count when that time comes. So when you transfer into eternity, you leave everything else behind. All you're taking with you is your character, and that's why the Bible says the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. So love is the big message here. It is going to be noted how we treated other people. Knowing this, he suggests when you wake up every morning, kneel by your bed or sit on the edge of it and pray, God, whether I get anything else done today, I want to make sure that I spend time loving you and loving other people. Because that's what life is all about. So every morning you wake up, remind yourself your big message, your big purpose is to love God and love other people. I don't want to waste this day. That's your prayer. Why should God give you another day if you're going to waste it? So if you forget that life is all about loving and caring and being there for people who need you, then you're just wasting your time on this earth. And number three says the best expression of love is time. The best expression of love is time. The importance of things can be measured by how much time we are willing to invest in them. So it's a bit like when people come here for training, which again, this is our home training park, where people buy this training and sit at home to learn it. It's got 30 DVDs in it, and all of them are like practical skills that you, once you sit down and work with it, you will change everything in your hands. And it requires time. When people come here for training, all I demand from them, of course, apart from the money they will give me, is their time. Because anything you are doing in life that you don't commit time to, that thing is not going to make sense. So time is the most important commodity we have on this earth. And you know why? Because we don't own it. So anything you put your time into, that must be a very important thing to you, because your time is your life. And that's why the way I'm taking this program is extremely important to me. This is time that I could have used in doing other things. This time is part of my life. So he says, the more time you give to something, the more you reveal its importance and value to you. So this program means a lot to me, and that's why I'm investing this amount of time into it. And the same thing with when people come here to train. You want to train and gain skills, you have to invest time in it. Anything you want to do in life that means a lot to you, it means you have to invest time in it. If you want to know a person's priorities, just look at how they use their time. Time is extremely valuable. Extreme is the most important thing we could ever say we have on this earth, and yet it doesn't belong to us. Time is your most precious gift because you only have a set amount of time. We've read this over and over. We are here for about 70 or 80 years when it's natural, and the tops is 100 years. So that's a set time. And so whenever you are spending time on anything that's not valuable, you are wasting your time. That time is wasted. And so it says, you can make more money, but you can't make more time. And somebody like Steve Jobs experienced this. The man who made Apple products. He had spent so much time wasting in life on various things that were absolutely useless. By the time he finally realized what he was going to contribute to the world, he became ill. And this time he could not take back. He could not retrieve his youth that he had wasted. You can make more money. So he made more money. He was extremely rich. But he couldn't retrieve the time. He couldn't take back the time. He couldn't make more time for his life. He said, when you give someone your time, you are giving them a portion of your life that you will never get back. That you will never get back is the time you give to anybody. The time I'm sitting out here reading this book to you is a portion of my life that will not come back again. Because the thing with life, it rolls on. It rolls on. You can only say, oh, yesterday was. But you can't get back yesterday. Your time is your life. And that is why the greatest gift you can give someone is your time. It is not enough to say relationships are important. We must prove it by investing time in them. So when you have a relationship with someone, it's not enough to say, oh, this person means so much to me. I love this person so much. I care about this person so much. He says the biggest thing you can do with that person is prove it with your time you spend with this person. So it's not enough to say relationships are important. We must prove it by investing time in them. Words alone are worthless. So whenever you chat with people and just tell them verbal things and you don't act it, they are absolutely worthless. My children, our love should not be just words and talks. It must be true, which shows itself in action. Relationships take time and effort, and the best way to spread love is time. So the time you put into anything, the time you invest in anything, is the love you have for that thing. The essence of love is not what we think or do or provide for others, but how much we give of ourselves. Essence of love is how much we give of ourselves. Men in particular often don't understand this. Many men will say, I don't understand my wife and kids. I provide everything they need. What more could they want? They want you. So he's explaining to this group of people. I'm sure this is the same with mothers. Most of us are like that too. We are so busy running around chasing this money in order to provide money for our children, and we're never with them. He says, what your child really wants from you is your eyes, your ears, your time, your attention, your presence, your focus. Nothing can take the place of things like this. Nothing. The most desired gift of love is not diamonds or roses or chocolates. It is a focused attention. So when someone gives you their time, gives you their attention, relates to you, cares about you, that's what love is. It is not gifts. Love concentrates so intently on another that you forget yourself at that moment. Attention says, I value you enough to give you my most precious asset, my time. So when somebody gives you attention, this is what it means. They are saying to you, I value you so much. And that's why I'm giving you my most precious thing, which is my time. Because remember all what we've said about time, you cannot make more time. Every time you spend some with something or someone, it's gone. And so if you value someone enough and you give your time, that shows you love that person. Whenever you give your time, you are making a sacrifice. And sacrifice is the essence of love. And Jesus modeled this. Be full of love for others, following the example of Jesus, who loved you and gave himself to God as a sacrifice to take away our sin. So Jesus loved us enough. He was crucified on the cross. He gave his life for us. And that's what they call sacrifice. So how much of anything of yours would you sacrifice for the people that you love? The best time to love is now. So sometimes procrastination is a legitimate response to a trivial task. So you're telling yourself, but I'll do it later. I'll do it at another date. Don't worry, there's another time. You say, but because love is what matters most, it takes top priority in our life. The Bible stresses this repeatedly. Whenever we have this opportunity, we should do good to everyone. Use every chance you have for doing good to those who need it. Never tell your neighbors to wait until tomorrow if you can help them today. Why is now the best time to express love? Because you don't know how long you will have the opportunity. Circumstances change. It says people die. Children grow up. You have no guarantee of tomorrow. Just like we know, once time is gone, it's gone. There's no guarantees. If you want to express love, you had better do it today, now. Knowing that one day you will stand before God, here are some questions you need to consider. How will you explain those times when projects or things were more important than people? Who do you need to start spending more time with? So that's something you really have to start thinking now. What do you need to cut out of your schedule to make that possible? If you've decided these are the people I need to spend more time with, what do you need to cut out from your daily schedule that will allow you to do that? What sacrifices do you need to make to show these people that you really do love them? The best use of life is love. And my sacrifice is sitting here and reading this book to you every day for 40 days. That's sacrifice. Plus my time. Because I really do care for you. And I want you to learn something from this book. Because there's so much it's teaching us about our life. Knowing today that time is limited. And once it's gone, it's gone. That should really wake you up. Because what we said is this is going to give us a new life. So if you find you're doing trivial things and you're wasting your time on things that don't add up, this is the time to wake up and start doing something about it. So the best use of life is love. The best expression of love is time. So when you put your time into something, that's love for that thing. The best time to love is now. The best time to love is now. So this is the end of today's chapter. But before we go, as usual, the question. Honestly, are relationships my first priority? That's the question he's asking you. How can I ensure that they are? We've heard how at the deadbed, people don't remember, where's my Lamborghini? Where's my Maserati? Where's my Bugatti? Where's my gold watch? Where's my set of jewelry? Where's my 30-inch wig? We don't remember, people don't remember that when they're dying. Because they absolutely mean nothing. And these are the things that we put so much emphasis on in life. So, how are we going to remember to make relationships more important than all those things? That's a big question for us to think about. And then meditation is, the entire law is summed up in a single command. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. That's the big command. That should be what you meditate on all of tonight and all of tomorrow. And that's in Galatians chapter 5 verse 14. So thank you so much for being part of today. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow, and God bless you eternally.